Okay, well, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Research Tuesdays. My name's Bob Hill. I'm the Executive Dean of the Faculty of Sciences at the University of Adelaide. I'd like to start firstly by acknowledging the Kaurna people, the original custodians of the Adelaide Plains, and the land on which the university's campuses at North Terrace, Waite and Roseworthy are built. Tonight's Research Tuesday is presented by Professor Leanne Pin Coe. Leanne Pin has been at the university for a few years now. He's an ARC Future Fellow. He has the rare distinction that when we got him here, we had to get him to wait for 12 months to apply for a Future Fellowship, because you need to be 5 years out of your PhD before you're eligible to apply, and he wasn't. So he really has had a remarkable career. We're very pleased to have him here. And tonight he's going to talk to us about conservation drones. So please welcome Professor Leanne Pin Coe.
I hope everyone can hear me all right. Thanks very much, Bob. It's a great honor and pleasure for me to have this opportunity to share with you some of the work that I and my team have been working on for the last couple of years. This will not be a technical talk, so I can promise you there will be no equations, no numbers. There might be one or two slides with figures on them, but that's about it. Instead, I will be telling you a few stories. So stories about how conservation drones came to be, a few stories from around the world where we have been using this technology, and stories about some exciting new developments right here in Adelaide about the use of this technology that some of you might want to get involved with yourselves. So my name is Leanne Pin Coe. I am a tropical biologist by training. So over the last 15 years or so, I have been working in the forests of Southeast Asia, particularly in places like Malaysia and Indonesia. Now, unfortunately, in that part of the world, we are faced with an urgent challenge. And the problem that we are facing is the rapid and widespread deforestation of many of the natural ecosystems. One of the major drivers of deforestation in Southeast Asia is the palm oil industry. I'm sure most of you would have heard of this issue, the issue of palm oil. In case some of you are not familiar with palm oil, I think this graph quite neatly helps us visualize the scale of the problem that we are facing. So over the last 50 years, the global demand and production of palm oil has skyrocketed. There's been a massive expansion in palm oil plantations around the world. Particularly in Malaysia and Indonesia, many of these plantations have overtaken our native forests. And currently, those two countries are the world's largest producers of palm oil. And together, they account for almost 90% of global production. And much of this oil is being exported to countries like India and China, and to some extent to the Netherlands. And from those countries, after further processing into secondary downstream products, they are shipped to, basically all over the world. So you can find palm oil in pretty much anything you pull off supermarket shelves these days, from the chocolates that you eat, potato chips, instant noodles, cakes, ice creams, to cosmetics, your shampoo, detergent, and other skincare products. So they're everywhere. One of the problems of this global demand for palm oil is that it's converting a lot, or it's resulting in the conversion of huge tracts of tropical rainforests. And one of the consequences of that is that it's driving the decline and loss of many of our native species in those forests. One of the most iconic of these species is probably the orangutans. And again, I'm sure most of you would have seen the orangutan either in the media or even at our Adelaide Zoo. But you may not be aware of some of the following problems that I'll be talking about. Now, unfortunately, there is an encroachment of human activities onto these native forests, there will be an increased incidence of human and wildlife conflicts. So apart from just destroying the forest and the homes of these animals, humans are also coming into contact with orangutans more frequently. And whenever these animals are perceived to be a threat to humans or to the cash crops that they are concerned about, the consequences can be quite severe for the animals. On the top left picture, you see an orangutan being shot by a farmer. There are also reports of orangutans being burned either directly by farmers or indirectly as the forest is being cleared with fire for agriculture. And then on the last picture on the bottom, that's a horrific picture of an orangutan being killed and eaten by some of the communities in those areas. But I think not all hope is lost, because there are a lot of very good people. They are working very hard to address this problem. The top left picture shows you an orangutan that's being rescued and carried out of a forest that has recently been burned. The picture to its left is one of a recently orphaned baby orangutan that's again being rescued and taken out of an oil palm plantation. In most of these cases, the rescued animals are brought to rehabilitation centers across Sumatra and Borneo, with the hopes that eventually they will be reintroduced into forests that are more secure and better protected from humans that might be wanting to do harm to these animals. Apart from rescuing and relocating orangutans, we wildlife biologists are also doing our best to study the animals, because to be honest, we still know very little about the ecology of orangutans. For example, in Sumatra, Indonesia, the last orangutan survey took us 4 years and cost us almost $250,000. And we were only able to survey half the island. So we don't even know for sure very basic questions like where the orangutans are located. New isolated populations of orangutans are still being discovered. So we are racing against time to try to survey and document the remaining populations of orangutans before their habitats are converted to oil palm plantations. And we are facing a big challenge in that area as well. As you can see in this picture, there is a very thick undergrowth in that kind of tropical rainforests. And the conventional way of surveying orangutans is to hike or to trek, or maybe more accurately, to bash through those undergrowth looking for orangutan nests in the treetops. And in this instance, you can see two researchers who have just found a nest, and they are using a GPS to mark the location of those nests. These data about nest numbers and locations can help us derive estimates of the population density of orangutans and where they are located, which is important for us to monitor how they are doing over time, especially in the face of rapid deforestation. But this is a very long and expensive process. So a couple of years ago, in just a casual meeting between myself and Serge Wick, who is a primate biologist who has been working on orangutans in Sumatra for the last 20 years. We talked about how urgently we need to survey orangutans, and that we really need to come up with a better way and a more effective way of monitoring their populations. And that was when we came up with this idea of flying a remote-controlled airplane over our rainforest with a camera attached to its belly. We were wondering if by doing so we could capture images of the forest canopy, and perhaps, if we're lucky, be able to also take pictures of the orangutan nests, if not the orangutans themselves. It was quite a controversial idea at that time. When we pitched the idea to some funders and to our colleagues, people were very skeptical. They thought we were just wanting to fly toy planes for fun. But I think we persisted with the idea and eventually got a small pot of money to do something about this idea. But very soon we found out that the available drones, the so-called drones that are in the market, are really expensive. They cost tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars. And as ecologists, we are not really the most well-funded among our scientist colleagues. We're more familiar with just a butterfly net and a pair of binoculars. And probably the binoculars is the most expensive tool we use. So we realized that we couldn't afford any of those commercially available drone systems, and we decided to look elsewhere. We did not give up because we really believe that this technology would be a game changer for what we are trying to do in the tropics. But more importantly, we realized that even if we could afford some of these systems, we probably would not have the resources to maintain them if we do use them and they crash in the forest. So because the kinds of conditions that we were working in were really quite challenging. We did some more research on the internet, and to our surprise, we found that there is actually a big group of amateur drone builders living amongst us. So these are just normal people like you and me who spend our weekends and after work hours building drones for fun. And fortunately, they put together a website that contains all the information that we needed about building drones. And so we had information on the type of aircraft that we would need, the electronics, the software systems, and even the sensors that could be helpful for our application. So using that information, we put together our first prototype drone, which basically is a toy plane with a few sensors, a few cameras, a GoPro, and a still photography camera. But the most important component of the drone was an autopilot system, like the one you see here strapped on top of the aircraft. Even back then, and this was 5 or 6 years ago, the autopilot system was already sophisticated enough for us to program missions on the drone and to be able to send the drone on autonomous missions. So we didn't even have to be flying the drone. We could program coordinates and have it go fly those coordinates, doing what we needed it to do. But there were lots of challenges along the way, and one of the biggest problems and earliest problems we faced was that the images that were taken with the drone was blurry. We couldn't get the camera to take sharp pictures that we needed for us to identify orangutan nests in the treetops. This was a picture from one of our early test flights in Zurich, where I was based before. And we had to come up with creative solutions to many of these problems, again, because of the constraints to our funding at that time. And one of the creative solutions we came up with was basically a kitchen sponge. All we needed to do, we found out in the end, was to use one of the kitchen sponge, have a cutout in the middle, and place the camera into the sponge with a hole at its bottom. And this became a very effective vibration dampening device. We even came up with a name for it. So it's eye sponge. So if you hear about eye sponge, it's from us. So we persisted with trialing the technology, with mucking around with the different components. And by the time we had it figured out, it was already winter of 2011. And here you can see a picture taken by the same drone flying over a field. And the pictures were then good enough for us to even capture footprints on the snow. Somebody even walked out, you know, hello on the snow for us to test this drone. So we were then becoming more confident of the technology, and so we decided to take a risk and bring it all the way from Switzerland to Indonesia for its first field test. And that was in early 2012. So this is us carrying a drone precariously on this long, narrow boat that was bringing us back, was bringing us up the river to a very remote forest in North Sumatra. And Serge Wich is the fellow behind me. When we get to the field site, we quickly put together the drone, fixed it up, planned a mission, and this was what I was talking about. You can quite easily plan a mission on a laptop and have the software and code the mission and upload it to the drone so that it can fly those transects over the forest. So we uploaded the mission to the drone, gave it a toss, flicked a switch, and off it went on its mission, its first mission. And soon, very soon, it flew away from us over the trees and went out of sight. Now, for those of you who are familiar with drone regulations in Australia, yes, we did fly beyond visual line of sight in our very first drone mission, which you are not allowed to do in Australia. And it was very exciting also because that drone that we built was basically a toy plane, and it didn't cost us more than $700 or $800. Although we did some test flights, we were not really sure whether it would work. So we waited 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and we began to have some doubts. Did we charge the batteries fully? Did we turn the camera on? Did we really upload the mission? So we began to have doubts. And 15 minutes, 20 minutes, began to wonder if we had lost the drone. We must have crashed into the river somewhere upstream. But around the 25-minute mark, we began to hear the noise of the propeller of the motor from a distance. And after a few seconds, sure enough, we could see the drone flying back to us. We were just ecstatic. You know, we couldn't believe that this $700 toy plane actually did work and was able to fly the mission and come back to us. So we quickly landed the drone and looked through the images that they collected. And we were quite blown away by what we saw. You have to remember that this was 5 or 6 years ago. And at that time, nobody was flying drones in the forests of Sumatra, Indonesia. So this was probably one of the first few video footage of the forest canopy taken by a conservation drone. Also, we immediately saw the potential of this technology for doing things beyond what we wanted it to do. So it could do lots of other things beyond just surveying for orangutan nests. When we got back to Europe, we thought that we must somehow tell everyone about this, share this exciting and promising technology with our fellow colleagues around the world who could do other great things with this technology as well. We posted all our videos on YouTube, and we had one of our friends write up an article about it on an environmental blog called mongobay.com. And that was really the first time the term conservation drones was coined and used. So after we did that, word got around quite quickly. Many of our colleagues from around the world started to contact us, wanting to know how to build one for themselves and asking us to sometimes to do so, to build drones for them and to come to their field sites to help them with exploring the use of this technology. This is just one of the many fleets of drones that we built. And in fact, we were so passionate about the technology and we believed in it so much that I took a sabbatical year off my academic life and spent the entire year building drones and bringing them to people around the world, mainly to fellow biologists and NGOs. Soon we roped in a few more of our friends and we formed we established an NGO, a small NGO called conservationdrones.org, where we could post all our experience of building drones on this website. Since then, we've been traveling to, I think, almost 30 different countries now. We started with Indonesia, but soon went to Nepal, to India, to parts of Africa and South America and so on. So it's been a very, very rewarding experience. We learned a lot from interacting with our fellow colleagues and about the things that they want to do with the technology. Now, most of the things that they're interested in, most of the applications can be grouped into three main types. So there are those who are interested in using drones to enforce or to patrol national parks or protected areas. There are those who want to use drones for mapping. And the last group of partners or collaborators are mostly interested in using them to spot animals and to count them, like we do for orangutans. So I'll go through a few examples of each of these applications. And these are the stories that I will tell now from around the world. So this brings us back to Sumatra, Indonesia, where we did our first field test. This is part of the Gunung Lusa National Park or ecosystem in North Sumatra. We went there and trained a local NGO who was protecting orangutans and the habitats. And after we left, they were using the drones to fly over parts of the national park quite regularly to keep an eye out for potential logging activities or poachers and so on. And unfortunately, in this case, they did detect evidence of illegal logging. So as you can see here, there's quite a substantial part of the protected area that was logged. And the people who did this were quite smart in leaving a strip of forest around the river boundary or the riparian area. So that strip of forest would have obscured the crime scene from any river traffic. And people who were traveling up and down the river wouldn't even have known that something bad has happened to their national park. So these data or these images were given to the local authorities who then took action to investigate and apprehend the perpetrators of this crime. This is another example of enforcement, or how you could use drones for enforcement. Here we were invited by the Fisheries Department in Belize, a small country in South America, who wanted to see if drones could be useful for patrolling their marine protected area. We were brought to a very small island on an atoll that's about 50 kilometers off the coast of South America. The conditions were very challenging, but that was the whole point of doing this, to see if the drones could be operated under those challenging conditions. And we were able to show that the drones can not only operate in those conditions, but were quite helpful in detecting boats on these protected areas. And so the whole point of doing this is to try to reduce the cost of conservation, and that's true for most of these applications, to see if we could do our work more cost effectively, basically, by replacing, for example, in this case, patrol boats that would have to spend long hours around the protected areas with a drone that would be watching, that would have a bird's eye view of the whole area from the air. So those are a few examples of enforcement. And moving on to mapping. So mapping with a drone is probably, to date, it still is one of the most feasible applications that we could use drones for. Just looking at this single image from, this was in Borneo, in Sabah, the Malaysian part of Borneo. The picture very clearly shows us how different parts of the scene has slightly different types of vegetation. You can see a more diverse stand of forest on the upper right corner of the picture, and that transitions to a more uniform stand of trees as you move closer to the Oxbow Lake on the left. By taking a whole bunch of these pictures and stitching them together, we could also produce what we call an orthomosaic, which is basically a map of the landscape. And that would be very useful for many of the work that we are doing. So this brings us to Peninsula Malaysia. We were there again to help a local NGO map a forest landscape. But when we were there, a local dam broke and the waters flooded half the township. So what started off as a forest mapping mission ended up being a disaster relief effort. And you can see quite clearly some of the damage that the waters had done to the village. So these images, or this map, was given to the local authorities, who then used them for some of their disaster relief efforts. Since coming to Australia, my team has also been working on some of the research questions that we face in this part of the world. This is a 1 hectare plot that was mapped in the Arid Recovery Reserve up in Roxby Downs. And this was part of an honors project of a student of mine, Matt Bowie. So what Bowie wanted to do in his project was to understand or to find out if there is a relationship between the batons that we have, or the many batons that we have in the Arid Recovery Reserve, and the native vegetation in the reserve. But to do so, he would have to somehow be able to quantify the amount of vegetation and the density of batons. That kind of data are really hard to come by for an ecologist, especially when we are working at that scale, at that large scale. So flying a drone, he was able to quickly map out the area, and not only was he able to come to estimates of the vegetation cover and the number of batong warrens, as you can see in this model, but he was also able to get a pretty good understanding of the structure of the batong warrens. So that might lead to further questions about the activity of the batons. It might be able to tell us if the nest of the warrens are active or not, and so on and so forth. And by the way, this is not a video. This is a 3D reconstruction of a batong habitat, which means you can use a computer program and make measurements of whatever you need to in this model. So you can measure the distance between trees, you could estimate the volume of vegetation, and so on. And here you can see at the center of the scene one of these batong warrens. You can quite clearly see the entrances to the batons, to the warrens. Now, this is another project undertaken in collaboration with DUNA, with the Department of Environment, Water and Natural Resources. Here, we are helping DUNA to see if drones could be helpful for estimating the fuel load in the forests that they are doing prescribed burns for. So as you would be familiar with this, DUNA and other agencies in South Australia conducts prescribed burns to remove some of the fuel load. But one of the challenges has been to estimate the effectiveness of these prescribed burns. So we don't really know, or they don't really know, how much of the fuel load has been removed. Now, by flying a drone over an area like this, so this is probably about 1 hectare of the forest, which takes only 10 or 15 minutes. And then after processing the data, you can quite easily come to an estimate of the volume of fuel load in the understory, and repeat the whole process again after prescribed burning, and to see how effectively the fire has been, or the burning has been, in removing that fuel load. And then the last group of applications that many of the partners are interested in are surveys, or animal surveys. When we started this project, our primary aim was to look for orangutan nests. And that we were able to do after a few trials. In this picture, you can quite clearly see the orangutan nest amongst the trees. But you could also quite clearly see and count individual leaves on those trees. So again, it just opens up the possibility of using this technology for many more applications when it comes to understanding forest ecology. For example, we could fly over the same area repeatedly and begin to look at phenology, look at the timing and extent of flowering or fruiting of these plants. We could look at tree fall gaps and have an understanding of how the forest is regenerating itself over time, and so on and so forth. We have also been using different kinds of sensors. This is a drone that was carrying a thermal imaging sensor, and it was an honors project of another student in our group. Here, Rob was using the drones to see if we could detect and count yellow-footed rock wallabies in the wild, and we were targeting applying this method to the Flinders Ranges. In this case, we were just doing some trials of the sensor at different altitudes and trying to figure out which is the best altitude to fly the drones at to capture the wallabies. More recently, we have also been working again with DUNA to use drones to monitor koala populations. In this case, we were out on Kangaroo Island for a few days and was using the drone carrying, again, the thermal imaging camera to look for the koala. In this case, amongst trees in a blue gum plantation. So it's quite surprising for me personally that this worked so well. The koala showed up quite clearly in these pictures. And this one, you could even identify two individuals, probably an older one with a young on the same tree. Another one of our students, Jared Hodgson, who is a PhD student, has been using this technology for counting colony nesting birds. This is a picture that Jared took when he was out on Macquarie Island. As you can see, there are massive colonies of royal penguins on Macquarie Island. And each one of those blobs in the background is a colony of, you know, tens of thousands, if not more, of these of individuals of royal penguins. And the conventional method of estimating the number of the size of these colonies is just that. It's just a very rough estimate. It's a ballpark, really. It's impossible to even count them carefully with a pair of binoculars. And this is another shot taken by the same drone that Jared brought down to Macquarie Island. It's just a massive problem for us. But now with a drone, Jared can fly a little bit closer and take pictures like this and do the counting back in the lab. And we're working with other colleagues at the university, and people like Ian Reed, computer scientist, to help to automate the process by developing algorithms to automatically count the number of bird individuals in nesting colonies like these. So it's one thing to think of new ways of using drones, like to use them for counting birds, but it's quite another to be able to validate those methods. So we need to know that the drone method, besides saving us time and money, is also giving us scientifically rigorous results. So another project that Jared is leading is to test exactly that, to see how accurate and how precise drones are when it comes to collecting information compared to conventional methods of counting them from the ground. And in this case, Jared came up with a very creative method of testing that by creating artificial colonies of birds using plastic ducks or decoy ducks. So the challenge in this competition is to see which approach would get the most accurate and precise estimates of the number of plastic ducks in these artificial colonies. So it really is quite a massive operation. That's why we called it the Epic Duck Challenge. It happened over a few days last year in the Aldinga area. We had quite a few students and staff mobilized. We had a team of experienced bird watchers who were doing the counts from the ground. We actually gave them an advantage, and we allowed them to be closer to the birds than they would normally be. And then we flew a drone over each one of 10 colonies at different altitudes and captured pictures of the colonies and counted the birds from those images back in the lab. So I'll be a bit cheeky and not reveal the results of this challenge to you. If you're interested, just watch out for the space. I think Jared is almost ready to publish his paper, and you'll hear more about this in due course. Moving on quickly to the last part of my talk, and that's where I want to touch on a little bit about training. I think I've mentioned earlier that we have been traveling around the world, bringing this technology to people. And one of the things we do when we are on those trips is to conduct training workshops to those biologists or NGOs. And this, for example, is a training that we did for some students and staff from the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute in Panama. So typically when we do such training, we show them very practical things like putting drones together, how to operate them out in the field. But we also do quite a bit of classroom teaching to go through some of the theory, the safety aspects of operating drones, and some of the local regulations as well. And at the end of such training workshops, the students would be able to capture images for whatever applications they're interested in. This is another example, a more recent example. We have started collaborating with Conservation International, which is a major NGO, and we're training their staff from across their country programs in the world. In this case, we were in New Caledonia and running a training workshop. As you can see, it's quite an involved and intensive process. The students would have to learn not just flying the drones, but also planning missions on a computer and so on. And this is one of the products that the students were able to produce at the end of the training session. This is, again, a 1 hectare plot of a dry forest on New Caledonia that the trainees were already monitoring from before. So now they have data from not just their ground surveys or their ground monitoring, but also from the air using this new technology. Now, coming back to Adelaide, we have some very exciting developments. We will be running a drone course in the middle of this year. This is a course that would be accredited by the Civil Aviation Safety Authority. So graduates of this course would become certified pilots, drone pilots, and with that certificate, you would be able to go work for a commercial drone operator or be able to use drones as part of your research. So this is really exciting. It's open not just to university staff and students, but also to whoever is interested in getting a drone pilot license. So I've talked a lot about drones and the applications that we have been using them for from the perspective of a scientist and particularly from the conservation perspective. But as you would have heard from or read from the media, there are a lot of other potential applications for drones out there. Lots of companies are starting to trial the use of drones for delivery, for example. Search and rescue operations are also starting to use drones. So lots of fantastic applications. From our perspective, what we are most interested in is to use drone technology as a tool, as a platform for collecting data. What is even more important to us is what we do with the data after that. So whatever the platform or tool we use, the most important thing is for us to process the data into a readily digestible form that we could deliver to policymakers and decision makers to help them make more informed decisions about conservation strategies or management plans to help protect what remains of our natural ecosystems and wildlife. Now, putting aside all the wonderful things that drones can do for us, I think drones are also an extremely powerful tool for inspiring future generations to become more interested in science and technology and in the other subjects that involve science and technology. Personally, I'm super excited and I'm really looking forward to find out what this child with this technology literally in her hands will be able to achieve with it when she grows up. Thank you very much for your time.